everyone. If I could just ask everyone to come inside and take a seat, we're going to get started with our last panel of the day. Everyone, we're going to get started. I'm going to invite Margaret Newman, the Executive Director of the Municipal Art Society, to take over from here.
Should we wait or? Okay. There we go.
Yes.
Do you mind if I move? Let's see, can I move this just a little?
Get closer?
Yeah, just so I can keep track of time and stuff on this. So, were you around for any of the earlier panels today? Or? Okay. You're ready? Well, if you're ready, then we should start. Okay. So we should get started. This is the end of 2 days of conversation, so we will try to make this somewhat entertaining, I think, and keep you awake for the end of the day. Just by way of full disclosure, I'm executive director at the Municipal Art Society. I also spent 7 years as the chief of staff at the New York City Department of Transportation. So I have some inside dirt on the last administration, and also I think some insight into what I think is a really important topic around all of this, which is who leads change in transforming urban mobility, and indeed in transforming urban anything, and how this leadership can be supported. So I think the last panel, for those of you who were here for that discussion, I think set us up nicely. I think they were a little bit pessimistic in their view of whether change is possible, and how that leadership, whether that leadership is existing, and how you do support it. I just wanted, for those of you that heard Secretary Fox's address yesterday morning, I just wanted to recap a couple of points that he made, which I thought were incredibly important and aspirational in terms of what our leadership and government and governance organizations should be doing. Whether that can happen right now at a federal level remains to be seen, but I think that they were really important points that he made. One of these was that we need to improve our public input process as we plan, particularly talking about transportation, large-scale transportation projects. How do we plan at the local and state levels? And really his which I think is probably somewhat unprecedented for the federal government to actually ask for input. How do we get input at the local level? And I think one of the things we've heard over the last few days is that, in fact, a lot of change and discussion is happening at the local level, and that's where some of this this input is happening. The second thing that I wanted to just mention that he was talking about, which I think is incredibly important, is the notion of regional planning. And I think that we have a lot of trouble with this as a country, as a region, particularly those of us that are living in the Northeast. We've been talking with our neighbors, fighting with our neighbors, neighboring states, neighboring cities about jurisdictional issues, and we've been trying to put in talk about things like high-speed rail, tunnels, things that connect one state to another, one city to another, and those things seem particularly hard to organize. And I think some of our regional and state, we don't have the kind of governance that allows us to really affect change at that level. So those two things I thought might be important to talk about. I think the last panel discussed at length the notion of public-private partnerships, which we may get to at the end of our conversation, but we'll leave that aside for the moment. So what I wanted to first of all thank, or second of all, because I've said a few things, to thank VREF and all of the sponsors. This has been a terrific conference and a really great opportunity for all of us to have this conversation. And I've seen lots of my friends from transportation that I haven't seen in as much as I've been working more in the land use side of things at the Municipal Arts Society. So it's nice to be able to combine those things. So one of the things that's really great, I didn't assemble the panel, so I give full responsibility to everyone who's organizing it, but there's a wonderful range of geographic diversity on the panel, and some of you I'm meeting for the very first time, some of you I know and have worked with in the past. So what I wanted to start this off by talking, having each of you talk about some examples of successful, and I think we're going to emphasize the positive on this, but we can also talk about things that haven't worked, but successful mobility or transportation interventions that you've advocated for or implemented in your particular regions. And I think maybe you want to start, Marc, and talk a little bit about you, where you come from and what you've been doing up there.
I run a design center out of the Syracuse University School of Architecture, and I came about 2 years ago. What happened while I was there was something called the 81 Challenge, because Interstate 81, which runs through Syracuse, was reaching the end of its useful life, so the question on the table was, what happens? So I feel like I got there at an opportune time to have an effect on that debate. This 81 Challenge had the requisite post-it notes and whiteboards and community meetings, but somehow the end result was polarization. Take it down, people in the city, keep it up and rebuild it, people in the suburbs. So we tried to intervene to say, well, what are some of the questions we should be asking besides keep it up or take it down? And enlisting architecture students and engineering students to be a little more visionary about it. So creating examples of what could happen and looking at precedents from other cities. What was surprising was those precedents weren't necessarily taken into account. It seemed like we were starting from zero, and cities, at least in the US, seemed to have to start from zero in thinking about these issues. So we wanted to really outline what the precedents were from San Francisco, from Milwaukee, from Seoul, and show that there are different ways of looking at these things. Not just mobility, but economic development, housing opportunities, righting wrongs, because the all too familiar story, the African American neighborhood destroyed, almost 1,000 buildings torn down, and this highway would split the city. So we were thinking, what could be better outcomes since we have the chance to do this again? So I don't know about the success. It's in the EIS process. But I think the debate has changed and the questions are broader now. So I hope success happens with the outcome.
Can you talk a little bit about some of the stakeholders? Was the state involved, the city? Who could actually lead that project for you?
Well, I think the issue, which was covered in the last panel, was a political issue. Does the governor really want to take a stand? With an election looming, did the mayor really want to take a stand? And it seemed like there was a little bit of a vacuum in terms of asserting what the best outcome for the city would be, especially with a county that has a very different demographic makeup. So it seemed like there was a little bit of a vacuum of leadership, because nobody really wanted to go out on a limb and say, take this down, a boulevard is the best option, or rebuilding it, even if it has to be bigger, might be better for regional mobility. So it seemed like there was a little bit of a vacuum. So I think our role was really just to make the, bring out those questions that could draw people in and create a more of a dialogue.
Well, I think we should come back to talking about it. Syracuse is a city that is stable in terms of population or losing population. I'm not.
Yeah, it's stabilized.
Yeah.
Slightly growing, but still has all of those problems of, you know, upstate cities in terms of very slow job growth. And I mean, with this expressway, it really splits some of the biggest job centers, the hospitals and the universities, from a downtown which is growing again, and which has apartments and condominiums and new businesses. So I think at this moment, we have the opportunity to really link those two things back together and create economic opportunities and also a precedent for other cities. Rochester, Buffalo, Albany are all also, probably because of their rough winters, looking at the end of the useful life of the expressways that split their downtowns.
Thanks. Brad, do you want to? I'm sure you have lots to draw on from your experience.
I'll chime in from your opening. I'm sorry that I missed the last panel, but knowing some folks on it, I guess I have some sense. And I do feel a real sense of energy in what's taking place in New York City right now. And I do think it's important to recognize that it's still a relatively recent phenomenon, that, you know, prior to then-Mayor Bloomberg's second inaugural address in his first term, he was not a champion of kind of alternative and more sustainable models of transportation. And so that's still a relatively recent phenomenon. And the fact that it, you know, we did a lot in that, you know, in those couple of terms, that Mayor de Blasio fully embraced that agenda with a different political frame, really, with the Vision Zero focus on safety rather than in some ways on mobility, but still enabling the agenda politically to survive and thrive in a new administration. And in the council, it's really been a very dramatic transformation. And it, just in my time, I've been in the council 5 years, and I kind of stumbled in my first year into a, like, international battle over a bike lane around the Prospect Park West bike lane, which seemed obvious to me that my constituents wanted, my local community board wanted, but became an international brouhaha. There was a big article in The Guardian about it. But at that moment, I felt very isolated, there wasn't a lot of support in the council or in the council's transportation committee or necessarily from the speaker. And we've really seen just an enormous 180. Our speaker, our transportation chair, a significant number of the leaders and active young members of the council are real enthusiasts for, you know, a whole range of things, for, you know, significant infrastructure investments in, you know, subways and buses, for thinking big about infrastructure, for the bike network, for city bike, for the bike lane infrastructure that we need, for pedestrian safety. So it's a good moment in the city. There's a long way to go. I'll say, you know, one thing I think is very important is to be working on things at a lot of levels. I think that's not easy to do. The scale of the infrastructure need is so large, it's hard to remember that for most people it is about their intersection or their bus line or what their walk to school is like or the drive. You know, that's more true in the city, in New York. But so we've tried pretty consciously to have things at all those levels. So on the ground in my district, we've been able to do a lot around mobility. Some of that is through this wonderful thing we started here. We originally stole it from Porto Alegre in Brazil, and then there was one alderman in Chicago who did it, and now we've brought it in very large scale to New York called participatory budgeting, where we take capital dollars that otherwise council members would be able to allocate and open it up to the community to brainstorm projects, shape them into things, get them on a ballot, have a real vote, and allocate resources that way. And it's just been at the scale of about $1 million per year per district. Started with 4 of us. This year it's up to 24 of us, about half the council. So more than $30 million will be allocated this way. And in my district, we have done quite a few pedestrian safety infrastructure improvements. bus countdown clocks, bike infrastructure improvements, and I think probably this year there's some people talking about doing some subway, modest subway station improvements, but real practical stuff, fix it first, things people care about and that make their mobility experience a lot better. So, and we've done other things on that as well. We did a big research project just around one bus line, the B61, that was badly underperforming. And people got so excited about being part of a participatory research project, which did indeed lead to meaningful changes from the MTA. Again, at the scale of a bus line, but pretty important if that's the bus that gets you to work or school every day. You know, at the kind of next level up, I guess the thing I'm most excited about at the moment is bus rapid transit in New York City, which got started in the debate around congestion pricing. I'll come back to that in just a minute. And we're really pushing it forward. The version people are looking at, the next, we've got a couple of routes now that have made, that are significantly better than what the bus lines on those routes were before. They aren't yet real robust, kind of full-featured bus rapid transit. We call it select bus service here. But it just, once you start, people want more and more. So the debate that's being had around the next route, the Woodhaven corridor, the community really does want it. And I think there's, for the most part, willingness to give up some parking to get it, willingness to do the advocacy for the investments that are going to be necessary. And so I'm thinking now, I have a bill in the council that would require the city to put together a citywide bus rapid transit plan. One challenge in all of these things is if it's just, you know, if it's route by route by route, there are the small business owners and the people who don't want to give up their parking spaces, and you don't have that network scale advocacy. So we're trying to think about how to combine the on the ground, kind of in the neighborhood, political support with building on the enthusiasm that exists citywide for a real network. And then I would just say, and I'll end here, I still think that, you know, our greatest defeat on these issues will still eventually be for the city and the region our biggest victory. I do think it's, though it doesn't look this way yet politically, ultimately inevitable that we adopt some form of congestion pricing and that we use those resources to pay for significant improvements in the transportation infrastructure in the region. The politics of getting there are very hard for all the reasons that you heard on the last panel. But I think you're seeing growing support. There's been a real good campaign around it that builds on extraordinarily good grassroots political work that some people in this room, like John Orcutt, have been doing for 20 plus years. But you can really see support growing, and I think you can also start to see people getting that ultimately there won't be a choice if we want to be able to get around.
So I think one of the things that you mentioned and that came up in the last panel was that sometimes the way to get to change is to start with very small, we talked about them as pilot projects, things that you get in the ground, changes that you make that people then see and they say, oh yeah, we want that, and if you take it away, we're going to be really mad. So I think that, I mean, the fight over that bike lane was absolutely astounding at the time it was going on, but after a while, this became, now it's something that some people will ask for, not everyone will want it. So who do you think going forward are, when you look to these, it's a little bit easier when you have, and it wasn't easy at all, but when you have these smaller, more discrete types of projects, if you're looking at big, complicated things, which is where we kind of are now, we need to do, as a city, as a state, as a nation, very complicated things. How do we, is there a way, do you think, to lead those, and who would lead it?
So, I do think that it is useful to do those small projects to build, to help people see that there's political support for doing it. So I don't, and then hopefully that gives people some courage. One thing that's underway in the city now for the first time that I remember is that as part of the 10-year capital plan that the city's working on, the agencies are getting together and trying to talk about that document in a more thoughtful and integrated way. And I think that's comes out of some of these smaller experiences and people recognizing you can build political support for a contemporary, livable urban infrastructure, because it's risky stuff. And I think we'll come back to this, I'm sure. How to deal with the competing layers of government problem is a lot harder, and I have less useful to offer about that, because even if everybody starts to, partly you just have the same competition. I don't have a good sense. You take something like the Cross Hudson rail tunnels that we need that are, there's a report that came out about 2 weeks ago that partly as a result of Hurricane Sandy, basically the sole train tunnels that travel, bring passengers under the Hudson, will need to go out of service, and we are utterly lacking in the capacity to replace them. A really catastrophic regional transportation failure. And I mean, on the one hand, everybody knows we have to have those tunnels. But the political situation is so different in Jersey than it is in New York. The competition between the city and the state becomes so so hard to predict about where the resource grabs will be. And so I do think that's a lot harder. I'll still say I think if you build those small projects and demonstrate the political will and this growing recognition that the only future for cities are to be, more transit-oriented, more livable, and to make the infrastructure investments, my hope is it'll become inevitable. But I guess we have to come back in 10 years and see.
Yeah, or hopefully sooner than that. but I think one of the things that you mentioned, which I think is really important and I think interesting apropos of some of the earlier discussions, is that the city, I think for the first time in as long as I can remember, is considering or evaluating budget expenses for projects, land use, and transportation together, which is really unprecedented at a planning level in the city. So I'm really excited, was very excited to hear about that. And Karl Weisbrod was just talking about that, who's the head of the Department of City Planning. And my experience with working at New York City DOT was a lot of the issues which needed to be talked about putting transportation at the beginning of projects was difficult to get in place because of some issues with the planning. So speaking of planning, how about Los Angeles? Do you want to talk about projects out there?
Speaking of planning, meaning how unplanned we are? Whoa, how unplanned we are. So just a little bit about myself, just having listened through the day. I think I'm a little bit of a different ilk, so to speak, in that while I'm a lawyer by training, I come from a lifetime of community organizing and outside advocacy. So I actually really do believe that big change can happen and that there's a method to it and that it takes a lot of resources and it takes a lot of thinking about power and how power can be built and how power can be dealt with. So that's really a theme and very much part of everything that I've worked on. So the things that I'm proud of in the past in my city that have led to a project that I'm working on now actually were touched on a little bit by the last panel. The Clean Trucks program at the Port of Los Angeles and Long Beach, which didn't just magically happen. They actually were part of a five-year campaign that my organization helped to lead that encountered enormous opposition and went all the way up to the U.S. Supreme Court. So those incredible reductions in carbon pollution and particulate pollution, the countless lives that have been saved really came because of long-term organizing and a very specific plan that was put in place, millions of dollars that were raised to make it happen, and then a lot of hard work. The other thing that was mentioned earlier, which is the one I want to talk more about and which leads into my current work, is the 2008 Measure R, which was a half-cent sales tax increase for the County of Los Angeles to, for the first time since, the 20s or 30s in Los Angeles, was a proposal to raise taxes on ourselves to build rail, to really try to come up with a planned transportation system where we could actually get out of our cars and where we could actually create neighborhoods. It was quite a piece of visioning. And I think that the leadership for the idea came from our then mayor, Antonio Villaraigosa, who was determined as chair of the MTA, our MTA, And, you know, the beginning, towards the beginning of his, well, towards the end of his first term, but towards the beginning of his reign, shall we say. But, you know, he wanted to put that on the ballot, but then comes the challenge in California, which for a tax initiative, you have to get two-thirds approval, which is virtually impossible. And especially you're talking 2008, you're talking the depths of the recession, our people, he must have been crazy to think that people were gonna tax themselves. And so he went to the constituency that had the ability to both provide money, but also to knock on every door and to talk to every person, and that was the labor movement. And the 2008 Measure R passed by more than two-thirds because the labor movement in Los Angeles put in millions of dollars, and they put in huge amounts of shoe leather to actually convince people that we were gonna be a great city, and that in order to be a great city, we needed a great transportation system that lifted all of us. And so out of that passage, and so I think the leadership came from our mayor, but it also came from an outside set of organizations, the labor movement and many organizations that worked with the labor movement, community organizations. And so when, after that passed, a number of us started thinking, well, okay, we're gonna get, we have $40 billion to work with, and of course there's a planning process, and we wanna be involved with that planning process. But let's think about how we spend that money. And you know, it's not often that organizers like us think about how we spend the money. We often think about how to get the money, or we think in broad terms about how to spend the money. But how to spend the money in a way that creates jobs, that creates economic development, that creates that triple bottom line that we're all so anxious to see, which in kind of wonky terms means really the procurement process. How can we, ordinary citizens, ordinary residents, ordinary people, conceive of a way to transform our buying process, how do we, especially around billions of dollars. And so we did a pilot project, which now has led to a national project that I'm running called the Jobs to Move America Project. And we first experimented around the construction jobs, created a national model for construction careers program, which got federal approval. Which normally, for those of you who know, the feds don't like any kind of local hiring initiatives because of the regulations. We were able to get beyond that and create a really great national model. But then we wanted to think about where are we buying our equipment. Now there's about $5.4 billion, and I should cut it off soon, just to tell you, $5.4 billion a year in the United States that's spent on buying buses and trains. And unfortunately, until now, there's not much thought that's gone into how do we buy them, where do we buy them from, and what do we get for our purchase? How many jobs, opportunities for women and people of color and unemployed and veterans, and how do we really use this to build up our manufacturing infrastructure? And that was the genesis of the Jobs to Move America project, which is having a lot of success around the country, and I'll talk about later in the conversation.
Great. It's fascinating to me that it seems like in California that you're able to pass some of this, what I think would be here, almost impossible legislation to put through, which has to do with taxes and how you support infrastructure investment. And I was actually in working when I was at DOT on a project here in the city to get sustainable street lighting, LED lighting on New York City streets, and we met with Los Angeles because they had such a great program, and it turns out that they had, with great foresight, passed this tax when the city was started, which every property owner paid, I don't know how much it is, some percentage of their a tax to fund street lighting on their streets. So they have this great fund, so LA was able to do this infrastructure program, and they were able to change all their lights, and Ed Ibrahimian out there is like, we can do this because we have all this money. And it was just amazing to me that kind of foresight happened. So
just to say, you know, we're the home of Howard Jarvis. So Californians don't like to be taxed. I would say Californians don't like to be taxed like New Yorkers don't like to be taxed, like many people don't like to be taxed.
Like most
but
people.
But with leadership and with organizing and with plan and vision, almost anything can happen.
Well, that is the amazing piece of it, that you were able to explain it and get it done. So anyway, we'll talk more about that. So Felipe, you were at Colombia, in Colombia, working in transportation, and then now at the World Bank?
Actually, I have switched several times,
okay.
Basically working public sector at the national and local level in Colombia and multilateral work, so IDB and World Bank right now. Just a point of clarification, was deputy minister, that's a huge difference. But let me tell you a little bit of a history that probably most of you know. So I was lucky enough that after college, my first professional experience was working with the National Planning Department of Colombia. In the late 90s, with a big, you know, process of policy formulation happened. We were working with a very successful mayor in Bogota, who was implemented the Transmilenio project. And we basically built a national mobility policy to support not only Bogota, but other cities developing these BRT systems. And that was really successful, and that's part of the history that you know, but let me tell you part of the history that you probably don't know pretty well, that model is in crisis, in serious crisis right now. And there's several, you know, elements of that, but I will just point you that it is built on a concept that, utopical concept that the systems will be sustainable on a full fair recovery ratio. That's impossible, doesn't happen in any city, in any part of the world. The problem is that Transmilenio started with the Caracas corridor, which, you know, it has been, even before Transmilenio, when I was a student, we measured that, you know, it has worldwide record mobilizing people in buses. That's because Bogota is pretty dense, so that corridor functioned well, but we built that policy, you know, for all the cities, all the rest of the corridors based on that premise. And what is happening right now? So all these private operators who have done investments in buses, in technology, around $2 billion so far, has been financed by the local banks. And they started to default on that. So it's becoming, and the second time that I was in the government at the high level position, I started to, you know, to be very critical about that. My colleagues, you know, didn't like that. And of course, my colleagues at the Ministry of Finance, what do you want, that we subsidize that, that we bail out? And no, there's other options. We need to move on the policy. So in those 10 years, basically, we didn't innovate the public policy. And I became really critical about the policy. And others, you know, Mexico and even cities in the U.S. have advanced more progressively on that. And so after finding that, we finally, you know, the national government is moving ahead. We approve important piece of legislation, like congestion and pollution charging, with this reglemented right now, and some cities are moving forward. But I say, like, really, the really change, the really, you know, new innovation of that comes from the local level. So by that time, government changed at the local level, and I went to work with a very progressive mayor in Cali, which Ford Foundation has selected as one of the Just Cities program. And they had, you know, this fantastic idea. So basically, the city has been developed around a rail corridor. That rail corridor has been abandoned. The city has been especially, you know, segregated by this corridor. Previous mayor wanted to build an express highway there. With the current mayor, we started to think of this idea of a green corridor. And the basic innovation of that is that you start to think beyond the mobility issue there. You start to think in more access, you know, outcomes in more, not buses, but non-motorized transport. This city, a few years ago, had 11% of the trips made by bicycle, and I think it has the potential of, you know, of building this superhighway, you know, backbone structure. You cross the city 15 kilometers north-south, perfect climate to get, you know, ridership of 30%, similar to some Scandinavian countries. So we are starting to move, you know, this concept of corridor, which to my colleagues, you know, in the transport sector, we're like, how many passengers per hour per direction was carrying? No, that we are not going to support that. So that's the paradigm shift, you know, that is not, you know, moving efficiently people, very engineering focused, to a more, you know, comprehensive view, including not only the mobility part, the mobility not just in buses, but complete streets, you know, bicycle, pedestrians, and other function of this corridor, the function of environment, to reintroduce the nature of this, you know, corridor that have full of concrete, very gray, you know, there's issues about climate change mitigation and adaptation, and the place function of this corridor. We are really not addressing that, and it has been successful, you know, just to be brief on that project in Cali. The city was broke, you know, didn't have any money to start, so I started with the mayor, okay, I will do it. I will start, you know, developing the concept. I will, you know, raise money, go to the multilaterals, the NGOs, and so on. And I left just recently, and the project, you know, with zero money from the city, has been able to raise, you know, up to $10 million, you know, in technical cooperation and grants. For foundation money was key, and it's moving forward. And part of the other job was working with some NGO to develop ANAMA. This is a new climate change instrument on TOD. So we developed that. It was one of the three first NAMAs approved worldwide on TOD, $20 million grant for the national government. And this project, I was managed, you know, with the double hat to get the money, part of the money to the Green Corridor project. So I think those elements are kind of guiding a new paradigm shift, you know, in the public policy. And I think Colombia will, again, by example, lead one of the progressive, you know, innovations, you know, in this new concept of accessibility around transit projects.
So it seems easier in some ways for things to change. I don't know if, you know, we've heard a lot of things coming out of South America in terms of transportation and sort of planning. And how do you think that that's, you're working now in Washington, out of Washington. How do you think that compares in terms of government structure? Why do you, or is that just a fantasy on my part that things look better in another part of the world?
Well, it's my recent experience was really hard, you know, to do changes, to reform. I don't know if it was because I was more exposure, you know, to the high level. I felt that back in the 90s was more easy, you know, to do things. And you know, just mentioning the Joshua comment that change is just triggered with, you know, when things get really ugly. And I feel, you know, for a reform, you know, on a transport policy that everyone, my colleagues were so proud, you know, everyone comes here and, you know, see this model and say, like, you know, it's a crisis. So until they start to default, you know, the private operators go to the local banks, you know, things started to change. So I felt a little bit frustrated on that. I don't think from the multilateral world you can be more influential, really. You know, I'm passionate about the public sector. Just have worked, you know, for that public purpose. But it's hard. You get, like, really, you get tired. You get, it's risky. So the strategy just go, try to do something, go to the multilateral, get some rest, and then try to go. That's kind of what I have been doing so far.
Okay. Well, let me throw out a couple of questions before we get to our discussants, who are going to pepper you with other questions. But so one of the things about working in cities, I think all of you know this, is that cities, and the cities that we're talking about, have been built for some time. They're not infinitely expanding. A lot of the real estate is kind of taken up. The street network is defined. And we need to work within those constraints. So given that sometimes the mobility question is limited by the physical design of the city, how do you present a new vision? How do you provide leadership to say, you know, changes are possible within this? Because I think one of the things people do typically is like, well, I like it the way it is, or why do we need to change it? So I'll just throw that out to.
Well, I don't think that poor people people generally like things the way they are.
Well,
I think that middle class neighborhoods at some point, although in a place like Los Angeles and many places, I think people are frustrated by how much time they spend in their cars and do want to have the opportunity for a better life. But poor people tend to ride buses, at least in our neck of the woods. Oops. So, the question is, how can we create a more equitable, an equitable region? And, poor people have many problems, and one of the biggest problems is jobs. And so the idea of looking at transit and investment in transit as an economic development stimulator, as a way to create business opportunities, to create good jobs, to create apprenticeship and pipeline, and just to lift up the economy, I think, that's one way of just you take a limited situation, which is your question, that you have defined streets, et cetera, and you come up with a vision for change, which does involve, taking down buildings and and going under streets, but you come with a vision, and not just the words, because I've heard this a lot in transit projects around the country. Oh, it's gonna create so many jobs, and the jobs never really materialize except for a few construction jobs. But when grassroots organizations themselves and poor communities themselves start organizing to fight for more transit in their communities as well as more jobs for their communities, then I think a lot becomes possible. And a smaller project, $1 billion can go so much further.
I think that's a great point, especially in the case of Syracuse, where if a highway is coming down, you all of a sudden in a relatively small city have anywhere from $500 million to $2 billion coming in to the city in a way it never would. And so if you can get that triple bottom line, you can change some of those outcomes. And when we look at the corridor that this highway runs through, it's blighted the blocks on either side. And so in a way, those things seem locked in, but just rethinking all the outcomes you want, not just mobility, but economic development means also then looking at the street grid, cataloging the values of the buildings that could be built if it was a boulevard rather than a high-speed expressway. So I think sometimes rethinking mobility as a broader picture really changes the outcome. The problem, of course, is jurisdiction. So the federal government is going to be paying for the majority of the highway, but the signalization or the now new streets that the city has to manage becomes something you have to deal with. But I think $1 billion, $500 million to $1 billion coming into a community with a little consensus can really go a long way.
So how do you think you get, let's say that Secretary Fox meant what he said yesterday in terms of having public input on projects, what are the tools that you have to sort of translate that project from the sort of grassroots level, from a neighborhood level, to say back to the federal government, we need the money because, and how did they define their needs, which are often very local and very kind of individual?
Yeah. I hope somebody here has the answer to that.
I had an experience. Started building our first rail lines in LA, and we decided we wanted to create this win-win idea. We wanted to create more jobs. At that point, we called it local hire. And we were told that the federal government will say no. So now in that one case, I found it useful to be a lawyer. Mostly I find it obstruction. So I said, well, that can't be true. So I put on my business suit and I went to Washington, and I got a meeting at the Federal Transit Administration, and then actually with the DOT General Counsel's office. But then I actually read the rules, there's a rule that says no geographic preference in federal grants. There's also lots of other rules that give a lot of authority, a lot of local authority. stuck on. Mm-hmm. And so that was a success story. And I think the same thing could be true of, you know, of a highway project. Federal Highway Administration is a little tougher, but there's still people, and laws are just words on paper, and they were made by, you know, lots of interests. So you take a look at them, and then you try to work it out. And I think when Secretary Fox is saying public input, hopefully he means public discussion, which public input sounds one way, public discussion sounds two way. So, you know, ideally, there is opportunity, at least with this administration, to find the win-win.
So I still think there's a lot of playbook development on things that are at the intersection of sort of more livable models of what urban life is like and what equitable growth looks like. And I actually think, unfortunately, a lot of what we did in New York City over the last decade kind of took us backward there, and we wound up in a lot of polarized fights, you know, where my friends in the labor union, you know, construction unions and affordable housing community just sort of bought in for a growth model. Folks in the neighborhood, maybe it's different in Los Angeles and New York, I don't care what neighborhood you're in, really the first instinct is, I don't want that change. I don't want tall buildings in my neighborhood. I don't want to lose my parking spaces, even if my neighbors and I don't drive. So how to organize people to, and I'll say this in a different way. I'm on the Local Leaders Council of Smart Growth America, and I helped found this new thing called Local Progress, which is our progressive, equity-minded local elected officials. And there's like three of us that are in both. Mostly it's those communities, we've got a lot more work to do because there's a lot of skepticism. People see growth and development happen in ways that doesn't make their neighborhoods better. And if we're, it is very valuable to have, you know, visionary design ideas for sure. But if people don't have the belief, you know, look, my school's overcrowded, my subway ride is overcrowded, there is no place to park. My first instincts are, if you're going to come with development, you know, you're going to let the developers do what they want. We're going to nickel and dime them for a few things. Maybe we'll get jobs. I think this is one of the challenges, the way we've done it here. There'll be jobs and affordability promises. Maybe those will be fulfilled. Maybe they'll be broken. But the idea that you could actually be involved in a public discussion about the things that would make your neighborhood even more a place you wanted to live, that would be thoughtful on the mix of preservation and open space. And I don't know if people saw, Michael Kimmelman has a good article on parks in today's Times that is trying to reconcile Mayor de Blasio's passion for equity with some of the more innovative parks development that happened in the last administration, and trying to argue that we just have to find some better ways of having that conversation together. Some of that is just good organizing. We're trying to do it in the Gowanus neighborhood in Brooklyn, and we've just spent a year trying to, you know, block and tackle and make sure everybody's at the table and see the things they need. But I still have seen many more places where those impulses get polarized against each other and don't get organized together in a way that makes a broader community of people buy into a model of growth that would both be more equitable, bring jobs and affordable housing, and be really attentive to delivering a livable community that you'd want to live in. Those things aren't easy. They need good design challenges, but I think even more than that, they need really thoughtful organizing if you're going to get there.
If I may go back to the question, and I think it's, and let me put in contrast Colombia and the U.S. is about the issue of the competing space in the right of way. Mm-hmm. And what is really amazing about this innovation and the public policy that has come from the U.S., the complete street agenda, is that it's happening, you know, in several cities in a country that most of the people drive and own a car, you know, 80-90% on average, not only New York. And I'm really amazed, you know, that has just happened in 10 years. I remember my first TRBs when we developed that, you know, and then Transmilenio was going on, the Federal Highway Administration folks were, you know, are you taking a lane, you know, the highway for buses? That was crazy. So that's really impressive, and that's what I like, you know, in this country, you know, the capacity of reinvent, you know, in a really short time. If you put that kind of policy question in Colombian cities with, and this is, you know, average for all cities, you know, almost 40% of people walk on a daily basis, 40% take transit, just 10 or less percent of the population own a car and drive. So if you just, on the example of this corridor in Cali, on average 100 meters wide, like putting a highway there in a city that doesn't have congestion problems is really inequitable. And you know, no surprise, we're one of the most inequitable countries and regions in the world. And that shows, you know, a reality of our society. But if you put like three elements, if you put the mode share, you put the road safety issue, more than 17% of the people who died or get injured are pedestrian and bicycles. If you put the investment issue, you know, the 100 more times, you know, more expensive to buy a kilometer of a highway than a sidewalk of a bike path. You have, you know, just so easy, you know, for a public official, if you have grounds of progressively, you know, an equity of public investments. And I think we should move forward not only in Colombia, but in most of the developing countries in that debate. I think we haven't been successful, and I reckon Robert Cervero's suggestion, we should invite more communication officers. We need, you know, in my time in the government, I spent a lot of time with designers to put nice presentations to try to sell these concepts. And I think we need to do that in the developing country, because it's an easy, you know, way reform that we can do on the equity grounds.
Just one thing that I learned, you know, it was a really powerful lesson. In 2001, we started organizing for what was the first community, or one of the first community benefits agreements in the country around the creation of the LA Live Center downtown LA. People don't know this, but that that started out with a lot of community opposition, because they were going to take a lot of housing, a huge amount of housing. They were going to take parking. They were going to take, and these were very poor SRO housing units. So you're talking very dense housing. A lot of people were going to be displaced, and you know, also the idea that this, you know, next door neighbors to the west and to the south were going to be, you know, negatively impacted by such a big project. And there was all this fighting and all this opposition. And we went in, and really what we did was we turned the conversation from backwards looking to forward looking. So instead of thinking about everything you're going to lose that you have, everything that's going to be taken away from you, we started talking about, well, think about all the things that you could gain from if we really are at the table and we really have them, you know, by the, and I won't use the expression, but by the nose, what would we want? And we actually spent a couple of days, and we covered the walls, and you know, and then we limited, you know, down to 73 demands, and then you know, it got a lot shorter than that. But it was just this simple thing of changing the way people think from backwards to forwards, mm-hmm. that got us really from no way NIMBYism to forward thinking. Community development.
I think that's a really interesting concept, sort of how you, you know, get your children to do things, right? So I think at this point, maybe we'll have our discussants come up, and Susan, do you wanna start off, or? Yeah, why don't?
Can you hear me okay? Well, I'm really happy to be here, and I'm so absolutely, truly blown away by this panel, just not just because of the amazing things you've actually done, but the way you've talked about how you have done it. And it's not just great ideas and examples, but it's just like how the leadership, let's say resilience, and the leadership diversity, it comes out. And I think that's the kind of question I want to focus on when I pose the question at the end. Hang on. This is a spoiler alert. The answer to my question about who, to your question about who leads is everybody leads. And I'm going to start by getting really philosophical. And of course, to do that, I'm going to quote Donald Rumsfeld. And he once famously said, we don't know what we don't know. And isn't that a great gift that we don't know what we don't know? Because then we have to actually start working together. And we have to be really creative and we have to be really smart. And we can't predict and we can't plan the winners. We have to actually create these ecosystems of very diverse folks. And if everybody's a leader, then everyone has to play a different kind of a role. So that was one of the philosophical deep things that occurred to me as you were talking, and as I was thinking about this beforehand. And the other philosophical thing is, there's a guy named James Carse. I don't know if anyone's seen Finite and Infinite Games, but it's just, to me, so inspiring because it says, finite games are played with the purpose of winning, and infinite games are played with the purpose of continuing the play. And I think if we approach transportation that way, if we approach cities that way, we're kind of compelled to say, ah, we get brownie points by connecting the dots. We get brownie points. We actually move forward by working together, and we move forward by actually not having it finished, like the master plan's done. We strengthen the leadership resilience by saying, ah, we have to continue this on. And maybe we'll think, well, how do we build new leadership? How do we actually train? How do we provide the skills? So we're kind of, I think we're at a transportation tipping point and a leadership tipping point, because we can't actually transform transportation without shifting the leadership opportunities. So, and I guess, thinking about my own experience, I am at a university, but I was a planner for a long time, and then when I moved to Michigan, we started working globally with cities, and do it backwards for a university, because we started working with people first, and then figuring out the research behind it, and some of the education that we could develop. But we work in cities in India, South Africa, Brazil, Philippines, China, and the US. And it's a really simple, really not rocket science, four-step thing of a little bit what you were describing about the post-it notes and everything, but basically getting all the sectors together, the leaders, the people from big business, big car companies, IT, entrepreneurs who can, create an app in the afternoon, and, public sector, but beyond the usual suspects. So yeah, you've got the planners and that, but you've also got, information technology and economic development and finance and social services. So bringing them together, and if quick four steps, first is starting with what is working, and it completely freaks them out because they're used to talking about what the problem is. So we're building on what's working. We map it out as an inventory, not as a visioning session, but an inventory for what's missing, what's great, and what we can do next. And then identify immediately over a course of half a day. And it's so not rocket science, but it really is transformative, because consistently, they haven't met each other. We usually bring between 20 and 60 people together, and they haven't met each other yet. And these are people in the same city. They tend to want to focus on what's not working, but this shifts it a little bit. They want to prioritize. They want to say, let's figure out what the key answer is. But to me, that's like God saying, do you want a heart or a lung or a pituitary gland? Like you kind of want all of them, and you want them to work together. And they think about the main transportation and then all the alternatives. And if you think about alternative transportation, it's such a sad way of thinking of it, because really that's like saying women are alternative men. It will never actually become the mainstream. It won't become a whole flat system. And then, of course, there's a tendency towards, if you're in a field, you think, okay, policy answers are the solutions. Market, it's the market. It's land use. It's social and cultural, but it's hardly ever all of the things together. But this work shifts it. And through the process of working on it together, people are transformed also, because there are people that step out of their stereotype. Let's say, like Ford Motor says, our partner in Ford Motor, sometimes I would have to say the human rights thing. Ford Motor is the only company that's done a car company that's done a human rights code. and, you know, having to say, wow, you're really passionate about the human rights stuff, but you might want to tone it down. I mean, there's just so much where people step out of their roles and allowing them, giving them a beautiful space in which this can happen around a map with a lot of stars and post-it notes and things. So it's really, I guess what I want to think about here is, if it's not public-private partnership, which is about, you know, going through a lot of processes and signing on the dotted line at the end, what about if it's public-private innovation? What about if we're defining the question together? And what about if we're identifying all of the different leaders that have to work on it together? So I guess my question, I finally got to my question, how do we, as a collective ecosystem of leaders, including citizens, or leaders or change agents, each in our way, set the conditions for transforming transportation as an infinite game in the context of not knowing what we don't know? And what are some of the tools and platforms and frameworks and cultures and practices, and maybe even business models that we need to help us transform transportation together on an ongoing basis and as an infinite game, not as a problem we can solve and win once and for all at 2 p.m. on February 23rd of 2018.
That's quite a question.
Yeah.
Anyone want to take that?
So I can just comment on the, and based on the Green Corridor project in Cali, really, I think the private-public participation, you know, with community is essential, basically because the innovation is really coming from there, you know, but public institutions are so, you know, busy, you know, with the traditional function, there's no capacity to do things, and this really, this colectivos urbanos or organized civil society that is really, even, you know, you can see here the High Line and other projects are coming bottom up, so that's essential, and it's essential also for a project like this that may take 10 years to develop. $500 million, you know, it transcends one administration, and if you empower that community, if you empower that community in the solution for the neighborhood that accommodate, you know, their history, their cultural dynamics and so on, that will transcend, and probably next mayor who wants to build up the highway there again, it won't be that easy. So so we really targeted that. We spent most of our time and resources to having these workshops with the community. That's what Ford Foundation like a lot, a collective construction of a vision of the project. And that will ensure, you know, the sustainability of that vision through different cycles of administration. So I totally agree with the proposal.
Seems like one of the things that you're asking, which is an interesting question, is how public and private partners work together in an innovative way, as opposed to asking, as I think was mentioned in the last panel, how do you just get private sector money to fund what you've already defined for public sector needs? So,
I mean, I'll take a shot at this, though it's a hard. I guess I think the problem like this. I mean, in the first instance, the resources are finite, so that is, you know, and it's not easy to. You know, people don't have today more money to spend on, a tax or transportation or housing. So it's not a good way to approach them. And it's not simple for us to think about how to start in a kind of a finite public sector pie. It is true in the realm we're talking about, at least in this region. I mean, obviously there's regions that aren't growing. But I'll say the following. In this region, we will achieve growth if we invest in infrastructure, and we will fundamentally limit our growth if we don't. So there is, it's not infinite, but the value proposition is good. Our economy will grow with investments on the one hand like the High Line, and on the other hand like rail tunnels under the Hudson. That, you know, if we don't build it, we will dramatically limit our growth potential, and if we do, we will significantly expand it. So there are returns to be gained through these investments, but most of the models pay those returns, you know, put today's finite public sector dollars into investments in which private sector actors will reap the benefits of growth later, which won't mean that they're distributed in any equitable fashion. They will just amplify inequality. And
it's very hard to capture that growth in a way that reinvests in public sector and community-based and neighborhood, both livable and equitable improvements. So, that's maybe just a restatement of the problem. It is possible in the best circumstances to get people together and say, all right, if we believe everything I just said, we could construct an investment, financing, planning, and distribution formula that would in fact let us, spend the time making the lists, imagine what those investments have to be to for the range of actors that you have, gamble, make an investment, put some public sector and some private sector capital at risk, and lock the returns in a way that will help pay for the set of things that we, so sometimes you can make that happen. You can't always make it happen. And I think we have some great stories, I think the stories we're telling are instances where that works. How to scale it, how to do that in a way that becomes more formulaic or, is a financing tool that means you can do it. Those are much harder, and hopefully, I don't have an answer on that.
Well, I think communication is something that we should all try to get to. In our case, it was more social activist. I applied to the NEA, National Endowment for the Arts, to do an urban rest stop, which was basically a way to get the people traveling on the highway to meet the people that lived in the community it was going through. And give the people in the city the amenities that highway people take for granted, bathrooms, food, access to information. So I don't know that it moved the needle, but I think it was a way of saying, whatever happens, this little intervention shows that you can actually have dual outcomes for people. And bringing together artists, letting people that, just think of Syracuse as that stop before they get to Canada, really see that this is a city that they're going through that has people. And, maybe if they're going a little slower, maybe if there's a traffic light for two of those stops, it might be okay, and that we're kind of in this together.
What I heard from your question was something another famous person said, can't we all get along? which was, what Rodney King said after the LA civil unrest. And I think that, fortunately we live in a democracy. Unfortunately, this is not an, equalized democracy. And we have intense power dynamics. And you're lucky. Most people at the Ford Motor Company are not eager to talk to, poor people in Michigan. So how do you create that dialogue? Well, you have to deal with the power dynamics. And I had this experience recently. We created this Jobs to Move America project. And we said, we want to make sure that you manufacturers of buses and rail cars who are selling to our transit agencies and using our tax dollars create more jobs, better jobs, create training, and all the things that our country and our communities need. And no one would talk to me. None of the manufacturers were interested. But then we started going to the different agencies across the country and getting them to adopt this US employment plan requirement. So now they're actually required, and they're scored for how many jobs they're gonna create and how many disadvantaged people are they gonna hire and how much training they're gonna provide. And it's amazing, all of them are really interested in talking now. So that's because we, use our public institutions. If you think about using your our public institutions as a way to equalize power dynamics, then we really have a chance to bring people together to actually come up with common solutions to societal problems, not necessarily to a problem that Ford and communities might have thought was, more apropos, Siemens or another rail car company might have thought was their problem.
So, Karl, I think you were going to talk a little bit more about some of these similar issues, or not.
Yes, yes, okay. Well, I will say good afternoon, and thanks to the panel for keeping it upbeat at the end of a long workshop. And I think the first thing I should do actually is decipher this mysterious acronym after my name. excuse me, just for those of you who are not aware, SloCAT is the Partnership on Sustainable Low Carbon Transport, and we're a network of over 90 organizations working on scaling up sustainable transport, largely within an emerging economy context. So to put my comments into context, I would first say that SloCAT, in partnership with, again, our network building on previous efforts, we're in the process of developing a broad financing framework in order to scale up sustainable transport investments on a global scale in order to meet targets of the UNF CCC process, climate targets, and the targets of the UN's post-2015 development agenda. So I do want to make it actually a bit more tangible. As a part of this financing framework, we're of course looking at capturing end user costs in the sense of congestion pricing, perhaps forthcoming in Bogota, Brooklyn, New York broadly, other places. Of course, it's been implemented widely, but not perhaps as widely as it could be. Certainly, we're looking at innovative public sector funding. Talked about participatory budgeting. Talked about the very bold Measure R in Los Angeles. But yes, initially, we're sort of looking at some private sector financing strategies. And so I know that PPPs have gotten somewhat mixed reviews recently in this very forum, but I'd like to know, are there examples? I mean, we've heard a bit about the Green Corridor in Cali, and actually, I haven't heard quite as much about the private sector side of funding that project, as I understand, has been a part of it, not just the public-private participatory process, but the actual funding of the project. So I'd be interested in hearing some kind of positive PPP stories that you may have to tell, and also looking at some other perhaps innovative private sector strategies, looking at expanding the use of bond financing, getting beyond traditionally the use of bond financing for heavy rail, ports, roadways perhaps, but getting more into the non-motorized sphere, getting into road safety measures. And finally, are there opportunities to look at directly funding, getting more direct contributions from private sector, the indirect beneficiaries of our transport investment? And again, I would welcome, I know much of this panel is based in the US and kind of focused on that, but certainly would be interested in your sort of out of the box thinking for applying this on a broader scale. The final thing I will say, if we're out of answers at this point on these topics, I would certainly welcome additional questions, because we found at this stage of our process, those are equally important in the questions we use to frame the argument seem as important as the early answers that we're finding in the course of this research.
That's great, I love that. You can ask him questions or pose questions to the audience instead of like that very much. So thoughts about any successful public-private partnerships? Hopes for some?
So I can try to answer the question about the financing. So for the corridor in Cali, we explored, the city will have this new framework of congestion and pollution charging. Parking management is also a policy that has been neglected in Colombian cities. There's a huge potential there. But in terms of the land-based instruments for financing, is an area that I have been advocating, and trying to move that agenda in the public policy for years. Cali didn't have, you know, the conditions to that. There is Bogota, which has huge opportunities to do as a bike-like instrument, like Sao Paulo has been collecting a lot of money based on auctioning the additional development rights on buildings. Bogota is right now planning and ready to start the construction of the first subway line, a $7.5 billion project, really expensive, and to be even financed by the national government and the city. And we conducted at the university and with the World Bank and a study of the potential money that can be collected around, you know, key stations auctioning those development rights. And it's a lot of money because Bogota has, you know, doesn't have more room, you know, for development. All the new development is happening, redevelopment on, you know, on the air. And real estate is really hot right now. It's even, you know, the square meter more expensive than several cities in the U.S. So that's, you know, a perfect, you know, moment, a perfect city, a perfect market, and a perfect project, you know, to explode those. Unfortunately, you know, for the Green Corridor, Cali is, you know, a lower than city with a lot of space, you know, still, you know, for developers to go. So there is, you don't have the conditions to explore TIFs and other kinds of them. The land use law in Colombia is a really advanced one, but the land use based instrument hasn't been really developed. There's one instrument, the Contribución a la Valorización, which has been really successful. Lincoln Institute of Land Policy has been, you know, writing a lot of that, but unfortunately some mayors have misused that, and right now it's kind of in the fridge, so that instrument is not being used anymore.
So I'm not a big believer in P3s. Many community advocates, I think they're a false promise. I was, you know, back when I sat for 10 years on the City of LA's Redevelopment Commission, and I saw a lot of use of tax increment financing, and I thought that was a little bit shaky in those days. Although I really did come to the conclusion that cities should be using more bond financing because it's a cheaper form of money, and as long as we can find a way, you know, to create revenue to pay it back, I think that's more honest than a P3 where you're somehow creating this magical idea of, you know, of a return that's somehow going to benefit the public. That said, we've been doing some work on the Purple Line in Maryland, which is one of the first P3 transit lines. And the RFP for the whole design, build, operate, maintain, finance of the whole Purple Line is on the streets right now. And we spent a lot of time organizing for, okay, if it's gonna be a P3, and if you're gonna give all that power to a private company like Macquarie or some other private company with not our interest at heart, let's face it, their interests are to make money for their shareholders. Then let's put guarantees in there to make sure we protect every sector of people that is gonna be influenced by this. And you know, the Maryland governor, to his credit, and also because of a lot of organizing and a lot of lobbying, has some unprecedented protections in there. So for example, on the construction side, there's a construction careers program, there's a project labor agreement, you know, there's a lot of local hire, and or actually using the model that we developed in Los Angeles, targeted hire. On the operations side, there's something called labor peace. So this is the first time it's been used that I know of. Basically, the operations will hopefully, because of labor peace, be unionized. So even though it will be private, the workers who operate are not going to be undercutting the Maryland workers in the public sector, transit workers, who may, you know, have fought so hard and so long for decent pay and decent, you know, conditions. So there'll be labor peace, and so they'll probably most likely be unionized. The third thing is that on the manufacturing side, they included our U.S. employment plan language to make sure to try to get more American jobs in the light rail vehicles that they purchase, as the light rail manufacturer is part of the team. So that is going to be awarded. There's four teams that have been chosen, and the teams involve all the different component parts of the design, build, operate, maintain, finance, or whatever. So of the so-called P3s, if there's really good, you know, standards and contractual language and all of that, it seems like the best way to avoid a really bad situation. That's the only decent one I've heard of.
So I'm getting the time signal, so I don't want to run out of time. I wanted Lee to just join us. You're not going to?
Well, I can. I think,
of course you should.
Because
I know you're going to raise a topic near and dear to my heart and all of our hearts here.
Let me do it quickly. And that is a great panel, and great to see you, Philippe, and on the phone, and nice to see you in person, and really wonderful comments. So as I shared with Margaret, I want to talk briefly about value pricing. And our issue, the question is, and I'll give you a little context before, you know, the issue is how do we get our governor, Andrew Cuomo, to try and push this over the line. And his calculation, I suspect, I've not discussed it personally with him, in terms of using his political capital, you know, he is not yet there in terms of using his political capital to support congestion pricing. I suspect, some on the record, some off the record, and Brad, thank you for your comments about value pricing, that a lot of the elected officials are moving in that direction. The RPA, which I chair, had a great conversation with all the mayoral candidates not to talk about it during the campaign, and they all followed that. And so we're pleased, you know, with that. And so the question is, and we've made great progress, again, credit to Alex Matheson, Sam Schwartz, Rich Barone, who's here of my staff at RPA, in terms of doing, you know, the leadership and engaging with all the stakeholders. So the question is, what advice do you have in terms of how we get Andrew to be supportive of this? I know that when I worked for Governor Spitzer, had a very brief conversation about this issue when he was in office. I said, Governor, I have something, or Elliot, I have something, you know, difficult to ask you, but I really want you to do this. I really want you to do this. And I, you know, said it was to support congestion pricing. And he looked at me and said, yeah, that's not too bad. I'll go with it. And similarly, David Patterson, who succeeded, you know, succeeded Elliot Spitzer after Spitzer resigned, similarly was supportive of it. And we came very close, closer than most people thought. It was stopped by four state senators, three of which who have been to jail or in jail. Messieurs Espada, Kruger, and Montserrat, and then with him who's not in jail, Ruben Diaz Sr., a lovely man. We came very close last time. So what advice do you all have in terms of how we make it politically comfortable? Because even though it is a user fee, it will be perceived as a tax. It is not going to be something that people, you know, just jump up and you know, say, oh, thank you so much for doing this. But at the same time, it's crucial in terms of the next MTA capital program. What advice based, and just something to add, you know, you had Enrique Peñaloso, we had Mayor Livingston in London, who did congestion pricing. Again, was a key political figure to doing that, and Mayor Villagrosa. You know, so you have, you know, what's key is that political official who decides to do it, to spend his political capital, and so forth. Obviously, the governor did that with the Tappan Zee Bridge, although not so much political capital, but he took that leadership role. What advice do you have in that exercise?
Well, that is an amazingly difficult question for a quarter of six or whatever,
right.
5:30 in the afternoon.
You can just ponder. You don't need to answer.
I would actually turn it around. I think actually where this panel started is probably where this might need to go, and you might want to weigh in, is that there, I think you're correct about the reasons, some of the reasons that the prior congestion charging plan did not go through, but I think there was another level of this, which is I think it wasn't understood in a very profound way among the people who live in New York and who were affected by it. I think there wasn't a sense, and you were working on the front lines there too, that they needed this and wanted this, and what were the benefits to the communities for this happening? And I think that speaks to some of the things that you all were talking about earlier.
We can leave it at that.
Well, I'll just say that kind of goes back to the story I told about the LA Live project and how all these residents were opposed to it. And then we, you know, because they were thinking about all the bad things were happening. Now, I mean, I think it's true, the research shows that with that kind of conversation than it is necessarily, you know, you're going to have to pay more money if you come into the city. So that's just one suggestion.
How are we going to spend the money, Brad?
So I'll say two things. You know, this week the governor was given advice by the Secretary General of the United Nations and the President of the United States, which he didn't take, so I hesitate to, be overly optimistic. But I think the obvious answer, and look, obviously what MoveNY has done and what you've done is based on this theory and trying to be thoughtful about the very diverse range of constituencies. So it's interesting. I mean, you know, labor was on board last time and the kind of environmental justice and business communities were actually on board.
Absolutely.
Now, that's true even though, in my opinion, not nearly a good enough job had been done locking in how the benefits would be seen by those communities. So there's no doubt we could have done better on what the projects would be, where the jobs would be, who would have them, how communities would benefit from those investments. So doing better on those things is important, although I will note, even without them, we had most of those core constituencies. It foundered in some, kind of quasi, for non-New Yorkers, quasi-suburban parts of the city. And the plan has been adjusted to try to be thoughtful about how to do some things in those communities as well to have broader buy-in. So, and I do think patient organizing, people are seeing, you know, the values of bus rapid transit, which would be one of the many things that would be bought, and some of that's happening on the ground, so more people are buying in. So I think the organizing is taking place in the right ways based on a lot of the kinds of things that we've talked about on this panel. So I think all of that is good. How to go from there, and to getting the support of a couple of key individuals for whom that's not necessarily that orientation isn't where they start. I look forward to those conversations we'll have in private.
Right.
This is what I'll say.
All right, well, on that note, let's thank our panel and our closing remarks.
I think this has been absolutely terrific and exactly what we hoped to happen, and you even turned into an advisory panel here for some critical reform work that we want to see happen in our city, in our state. So for those of you who are going to the dinner, I hope to see you there at 7 p.m. There's still spots if some of you would like to join us at the famous Oyster Bar at Grand Central Station, one of our great transport hubs here in the city, and also a fun place to be. So with that, I hope to see many of you tomorrow. Thank you very much for sticking with us the whole day and participating. Take care.